First of all, I would like to thank President Ivanov for the kind invitation. It is both a pleasure and an honor to be here and speak to you in memory and commemoration of Eugen Grishin. I also want to thank Professor Alexander Vasilevsky for the warm welcome yesterday evening, afternoon, and also the practical organization. I have the pleasure to give an overview of disulfide pore conopeptides, which I hope I can convince you is a class of pharmacologically interesting compounds. But before doing so, please, in 1 minute, let me explain my relation with Eugen Grishin. And if you see the picture on the right, this is Eugen visiting Leuven, my university city in Belgium. It's the main university, the Catholic University of Leuven, on the occasion of the European section meeting of the International Society of Toxinology in 2008. And it's kind of an important picture taken by Alexander Vasilevsky, because just behind Eugen, you will see the most famous statue in Leuven city center, and then behind our city hall, which is the typical Gothic Flemish style. But focus not only on Eugen, of course, but then also the small statue behind. This represents the archetype of the student in Leuven. And Leuven, you have to know, is the seat of the world's largest brewery in beer, InBev, with the brand Stella Artois. It's really from our city. And the question here, in relevance with Eugen, is what should a student do? When a student starts his career, can he study the neurobiology of alcoholism, pouring, intoxicating for 4 or 5 years his brain with alcohol? Or should he follow in the footsteps and the path of a famous scientist, Eugen, and do something really useful with his career, learning, becoming a researcher? And of course, this is then the heritage and also the legacy we have from Eugen. And on the left, I've taken some publications where I really feel that it was not only an honor, but also a privilege to have learned so many things from Eugen in the field of toxinology in particular, where I've known Eugen since the last more or less 20 years, and we had in the meantime, as we speak today, some bilateral collaborations also. And as you can see from selected papers that I've shown on the left, the first one we published was a BBRC paper back in 2001. But since then, even up to now, we have several papers where, again, in good journals like JBC, where the input, education-wise, and also the vision strategy of Eugen is clearly an example. And of course, we are extremely grateful for this, because this paved the way also for toxinology in Belgium, in Leuven, and also in my career. Coming to the topic of neurobiology and cones, we all know the beautiful cones and the shells that are collector items, and they have been around since some time. Back in the 1600s, you know, the famous painter Rembrandt van Rijn, who painted this famous Nachtwacht painting that can be seen in the State Museum of Amsterdam. Many people know this painting, but also he painted at the same time a Conus marmoreus back in 1650. So there was an interest in these interesting animals. And it's said that also paintings from Johannes Vermeer, also a famous Dutch painter from the same era, that at that time it was more valuable and precious to collect in the 18th century these cones that came from the Far East, as opposed to purchasing and being the proud owner of a painting of Vermeer. Nowadays it's quite the opposite, as you can imagine. But just to give you the historical entrance. Now, we as toxinologists and scientists, we are of course interested in this beautiful animal with the venom bulb on the one hand and the proboscis on the other hand. What is this organ, what is this element in the venomous and poisonous animal doing? Here is a schematic representation, again now from the right to the left, the venom bulb and then the proboscis with beautiful pictures of a harpoon-like mechanism, a kind of a needle-type instrument via which all the toxins and the venom is injected. This phylogenetic tree I briefly show for the reason that we know that several cones hunt on worms, W, sometimes on fish or on mollusks. And this is also reflected in the pharmacology and the discovery of the peptides we see, which can then of course be used for drug development. Coming now really to neurobiology, the topic also of the symposium. It was back in 1999 already that Toro Oliveira, famous toxinologist active in this field, discovered that when you inject the venom of a particular comb in a rodent, that you have a wonderful, that's a plethora of symptoms. The symptoms are extremely diverse, as you can see, so I will not go through all of them, but it can go from excitatory, inhibitory effects to convulsions and death. So a very impressive pharmacological platform. Later on, and we have already seen passing the review of some of these molecular targets, both in the periphery as well as in the central nervous system, more and more we try to understand what these molecular targets could be. And they can range from G protein coupled receptors to ligand gated receptors, to voltage gated, proton gated ion channels. And of course, when we try as a toxinologist to link our knowledge of conopeptides with all these targets, we hope to have a better understanding to explain the symptomology, but also in the field of valorization of these compounds into drug discovery. What is the workflow? I will not dwell on that too long. Still, very traditionally, when as a toxinologist you have a venom, not only from cones, but also spiders, scorpions, snakes, you name it, then you can do the classical HPLC purification, the classical still Edman degradation sequencing, or more and more MSMS-based sequencing. Then it's very useful to have an NMR structure, quite often from a synthetic or recombinant variant, because the amounts are very tiny. And then you also want to know what is now the function once you know the primary, secondary structure of these peptides. And since approximately 25 years in my lab, we have indeed all the techniques mentioned in this workflow diagram, but we have focused on the electrophysiology, where the essence of our system is the following. We have a library, as we speak, of about 80 copy DNAs in our freezers, so ranging from ligand-gated, voltage-gated ion channels, receptors, so sodium channels, potassium channels, calcium channels, but also opiate receptors, cannabinoid receptors, nicotinic receptors. And once you have this cDNA, you can make in vitro RNA, do a nano-injection in the oocytes of this Xenopus levis system. The oocyte knows how to translate and process, and then you can do the classical voltage clamp electrophysiology. So it's a very simple, but also robust and open system, enabling the toxinologist to learn what the pharmacology is. Recently, we are very happy also to upscale all the screening efforts and characterization. And this is a high clamp instrument originally designed by Daniel Bertrand from Geneva, and it's now on the market. And this is really now, for the first time, high throughput, not only high throughput screening in voltage clamp, but also high throughput characterization of peptides, neuropeptides, and toxins. And the beauty of the system is very simple. You have, as you can see, two 96 well plates. And in one plate, you can position every time one oocyte. One oocyte that has been injected with a particular target, nicotinic, sodium channels, and so on. And the other plate, you can load with a particular toxin, peptide, a fraction, whatever you want. And the system then will transfer, as you can see here, will transfer the oocyte in a type of basket, an electrically controlled basket system, transfer the oocyte from the one plate to the other, do the electrophysiological measurement in the other plate, and then rinse it and put it back. So no dead volumes anymore, no waste of the toxins or fractions you want to study, because it remains in the well. So that's now implemented in my lab, and we definitely hope to, for the next years, to upscale our screening efforts even more. Coming back to the peptides and the conopeptides, you will find a lot of data in the literature about the cysteine-rich peptides. And they're classified in superfamilies with a cysteine framework, families, target. And as you can see, the targets are classical ones, nicotinic receptors, voltage-gated ion channels, sodium, potassium, calcium. I will not speak on that because they have received attention already, I think, sufficiently. And what is more important is a kind of neglected family of conopeptides that we call disulfide poor or even disulfide free peptides. And I want to give you an overview on this symposium of 13 families we have reviewed, some of which we also have contributed. And it's not the purpose, of course, to go home with a recollection of all these 13 families and the sequences I will show, but I hope to give you a sense of the unknown pharmacology behind many of these peptides. They are very small, and especially in neuropharmacology, neurobiology, what these peptides still could represent in the future. So the very first family are the conopressins. We talk about 1987. The conopressins, we know five representatives today. When you inject them in mice, they produce a scratching effect, which is very similar to neurohypophyseal hormones in also humans. And indeed, when you check the very short sequence, and they also contain only one disulfide bridge, there is a resemblance with the vasopressin that we know, the vasopressin molecule that acts on the vasopressin receptor, which is a GPCR. There is also a nice homology with the oxytocin receptor, again a GPCR, and also vasotocin that has been described in the literature. You can see all these peptides are very, very similar. So there is a fish equivalent of oxytocin. Cones also reproduced or produced this. So it's clear that this first family is an example of peptides being produced, not restricted to vertebrates, and this hints to an old lineage. If you do evolution studies, this is a very, very old lineage of peptide production. According to the author specialized in these, it is important for fish hunting Conus snails. What do they do in terms of physiology? Well, they act almost like a hormone. They are important in water balance, blood pressure, contraction of smooth muscle, aggression, depression, bonding of creatures. And do we understand how? No, we don't. Because if you take the example of conopressin T, so the previous last one here, it is known from structure function studies that it's a selective vasopressin 1A antagonist, but on the oxytocin receptor it's an agonist. So you have, let's say, opposing effects. What we do know is that prolin 7 and glycine 9 are important epitopes for the pharmacology. Second family, the chondrifans. Here you see more representatives, approximately 15 to 20 in the literature described, and what strikes immediately is that they are subjects of an incredible post-translational modification system. So you will find epimerization, L2D, you will find bromination, hydroxyproline, amidation of the C-terminus. So nature here evolves in terms of evolution very extensively in terms of this PTM. There is a conserved motive. We know this chondrifan since 1996. The conserved motive is shown with the tryptophan in the D form. The N-terminal cysteine, hydroxyproline or cysteine proline is important in terms of function that we know in the frame of cis-trans isomerization, and the cis is the relevant one to have pharmacology. And the bromochondrifan was the very first example of a brominated tryptophan amino acid, and this has been beautifully elaborated and published by the Jimenez and co-workers, where it was found that when you start from the gene over mRNA and then you have a prepropeptide, that in fact the bromination is an event that follows hydroxylation, epimerization, and C-terminal amidation. So bromination is kind of a secondary PTM following the classical ones. What is then the 3D structure? It is almost like a kind of a cyclotide. So this one disulfide bridge closes this mini protein, the peptide, rendering it very stable, resistance to, for instance, proteases. Third family, the conocaps. Only three members are known, perhaps not so important as we know now for neurobiology, but more for cardiophysiology. They have been published in 2010. They are indeed cardioactive peptides. It has been shown that they decrease heart rate and blood pressure in rats. Crustacean also have a similar peptide, CCAP, but now with an opposite pharmacology. We know that the cis residues are crucial for activity, so you have one disulfide bond, which is logical. But the target is still a mystery, question mark. People have assayed it on voltage-gated calcium channels. We also have assayed it on many, many of our targets in the lab. We have not found a hit. The fourth family, one unique member that we found last year and that we published recently. We called it Conogay peptide from Australis, Conus australis. This is now a kind of a peptide without any PTM, without post-translational modification and one disulfide bridge. We tried to, with the Cono servers and other databases, to link it to any other family, impossible. So no PTMs. What is the target? Honestly, we don't know. And here below, you see such an example of our electrophysiological screening that we do. So we assayed all the voltage-gated sodium channels that we have from the human genome, from NAF 1.1 to 1.9. Then we have the Shaker, Shao, potassium channel, also the HERG, EHE, two-pore background potassium channels. We have screened them all. Also for the nicotinic receptors, the muscle type, the neuronal type, homomeric, heteromeric, nothing worked. So the TARC is still a mystery for this sole member of this fourth family. The conantopins, there we know more about, as you can see, approximately 15 representatives. And here, quite interestingly, you see a lot of gamma-carboxyglutamic acids. So they are very much loaded, these peptides, with gamma-carboxyglutamic acid. We know them since, indeed, for a while, since 84. They have now no cis residues, so they are really this disulfide-free. And the name derives from the sleeper peptide in mice, conantopin. And this relates back to the original work by Oliveira and collaborators in the Philippines. Because if you go to local Filipinos, the Filipino word for sleepiness is antokin. So coming from conus is then, of course, logical, the conantokins. So they induce sleep. What we know in terms of molecular target is that they are competitive antagonists of the NMDA receptors at the glutamate binding site, mostly type 2A and D. People think that the conus, as species, uses these peptides in an offensive hunting strategy. It's part of the Nirvana cabal, corresponding to Oliveira's theory. So they produce a jerky swimming behavior, but also in a defensive strategy. The injection of a potent glutamate antagonist in invertebrates leads to inhibition of signal transmission. So this is very, very efficient also in terms of defensive strategy. Now, the conantopins are highlighted by a disproportionately large number of PTMs, as I said, gamma carboxyglutamic acid. Why? Well, people think that they have an importance in the chelation of divalent cations, causing a stabilization of the alpha helical secondary structure. In the next slide, I will show you. What else do we know in terms of structure function? They have important epitopes. We know position 2, 4, and 12 are important. And position 5, quite interestingly, for the pharmacologist among you, determines the NMDA receptor type subtype selectivity. And as such, it's no wonder that such molecules belonging to the conantopins have been considered as lead compounds for the further development, for instance here, for the treatment of epilepsy. And this is then the overall structure. It is a very simple helix, a helix that is almost amphiphatic or amphiphilic, because the gamma carboxyglutamates all point in one direction, and the more hydrophobic amino acids the other way. Sixth family, the contulakins. Only one member is known, highly post-translationally modified. We know it since 1999. And here again, there is an interesting link to neurobiology, because in vertebrates, we see the molecule neurotensin. Neurotensin is very similar to what the conus produces. And this, in my opinion, was the very first example for a conopeptide emphasizing the importance of glycosylation, not only classical amino acid modification, but glycosylation at threonine 10. This renders the 10 times more potent isoform than the unglycosylated form, and it should play a role in the desensitization of the target. The target is obvious, the neurotensin receptor. The neurotensin receptor 1 and 2 are GPCRs, and they could modify the three variants. What does it do in terms of organ physiology? People say it regulates the dopaminergic system in the brain. Also the opiate-independent analgesia, whatever mechanism is behind, I don't know. Also digestive processes and food intake. So contulakin G in venom suppresses sensory circuit in prey, and therefore it's also a very attractive molecule for drug discovery. This CGX molecule is now, or was, in the development for the treatment of chronic intractable pain. Seventh family, the Gonorf amides. Three members are known since 2002. The RF amide neuropeptide family is an incredibly large family, well known among biologists that are interested in insect peptide neurobiology. The signature FMRF amidated is a hallmark. They target GPCRs, that is something we know. Neuropeptide, FF1R and 2R, pyroglutamated RFamide peptide R. For instance, if you talk to biologists, really specialists in insect development, they all know about the KISS peptin, the prolactin-releasing peptins. So conuses also produce these peptides that are very, very homologous to what insects are capable of producing. What does it do when it's injected in vertebrates, like in rodents, in mice? It causes hyperactivity. Hyperactivity with an increase in the intracellular calcium levels. How? We don't know, but it's a clear effect. Therefore, it also modulates muscle contraction, water balance, and neuronal activities. The eight family, the colophans, fairly new since 2005, only four members are known, but very homologous. They have a high degree of PTM with epimerization and gamma hydroxylation of valine, so the L2D isoforms, and also other valine and hydroxyvaline production. This would increase the stability and potency, but the target is still unknown. They are there in the venom, we have absolutely no clue what they do. Then the conomap, again, one member here only, complete disulfide free, since we know it since 2006. A tetradecapeptide is it with 65% homology to the myoactive peptide family, the so-called MATPs. We believe it's an endogenous neuromodulator in mosses and insects. The D, phenylalanine, leads to enhanced biological activity, but the target is still unknown. Then the conomarfins, three representatives so far. 2008, it has begun. They have a cDNA encoded precursor when you do the molecular biology approach of characterizing these toxins with a conserved signal peptide with the M superfamily of conotoxins. And these are classical cysteine-rich type of conotoxins. So sometimes the pre-pro peptide is more identical or homologous than the final and mature peptide. There is significant PTM with epimerization at proline and hydroxyproline. This is important for structure. And interesting here, when we screened all the database and the literature, is that when you look at conomarfin 8, it is the result of a cleavage between alanine at 6 and histidine at position 7. So here, the cleavage, and then you have a new peptide. You can say this is by chance, but it isn't. According to the paper and the publishers, they really have consistently been able to show the simultaneous presence of conomarfin 8 with the 14. Why? We have no idea, because also the target and function is still unknown. And this is a very simple structure. Then the conolysins, two representatives, we know them since 2007. They disrupt integrity of cell membranes, so they are cytolytic peptides. And cytolytic peptides, many of you in the audience will recognize, we can find them in bacteria, viruses, insects, marine invertebrates, reptiles. When you inject them in vertebrates, like in rodents, mice, they do a kind of very strange backward shuffling mode, a kind of moonwalk behavior. And the conolysin MT1 that you see is more active against gram-positive than gram-negative bacteria, but not a very nice lead compound in terms of potency when you compare it, for instance, with the melitin that can be found in the bee venom. There is still a potential of antifungal or antiviral, but still a lot of work has to be done. And then the previous last one, the conoNPYs. We know these, we have two representatives among the conopeptides, conoNPY, NPF, N-terminally amidated. We know them since 2010. And they have a link with the NPY-like exocrine conopeptides or peptides in vertebrates and as well in invertebrates. And what do we know in terms of function? We know that they have a role in feeding behavior, energy balance, blood pressure, circadian rhythm, sexual behavior, memory processing, cognition, anxiety, epilepsy. A representative of the NPY peptide invertebrates, I've shown it, they have the full sequence you can see, always amidated and C-terminally, but not many other PTMs to be seen. They cause hyperactivity, jumping and moving in circles of mice, tail flicking, but unfortunately, we know that the NPY receptor is a classical GPCR, but whether these molecules, peptides, are the true ligands for this GPCR is really, really unclear. So a lot, again, is to be done. And then the last one is the hormone-like conopeptide family with two members, the 11-in and the prohormone. Very recent data, we know these from 2015. And the precursors of prohormone for VC1, identified in the venom gland, quite interestingly, can also be found in many Scolus species. So it's not restricted to this one VC species alone. You can also find it in Geographus, Tessulatus, Varus, and Virgo. And what we know from insect biology is that in the honeybee, for instance, the prohormone 4, identified in the brain of this insect, regulates behavior. However, here again, the target, at least in vertebrates, remains to be discovered. And I will end with some unpublished data of a collaboration with Alexei Navarro from Mexico, where we studied Conus ximenes. And we could find the lowest sequence, a classical alpha-4-3 conotoxin, this time a cysteine-rich small peptide, given the size. That's a classical nicotinic-type antagonist. You can see here the alpha-7 neuronal homomeric receptor that we express. You can block it with this XM1A peptide very efficiently, and it does not affect all the other isoforms of the nicotinic receptor. But why do I show this? Okay, this is well known, I think, to the audience, so I will skip that. We found also that together with the XM1A, we have an amidated variant, so amidated adafalin. And indeed, we compared now the effect of amidation. And as you can see, and as I've shown you also for the 13 subfamilies, the simple amidation as a most simple PTM can be causing a clear shift in the activity. So it really makes a difference. But more surprisingly, together with the XM1A we discovered, the amidated one, we had a very, very hard time in elucidating the structure of this C variant. And the reason was that it always came out as a dimer, kind of a dimeric. So it was not easy for sequencing, even via mass spectrometry or Edman, but finally it was resolved, and this is a structure of this 1C. And as you can see, this 1C isoform is composed of an N-terminus and then the C-terminus, rearranged, cleavage and rearranged. By chance, we don't think so, because it's constantly present in the venom. At any, let's say, prep we did, it's always there. We then, of course, checked the pharmacology of this dimeric mini-peptide. No function. To be expected, it would be a surprise if this also is a classical nicotinic type of antagonist or blocker. What does it do in the venom? Again, we have no idea. But it reminds us of human physiology and, of course, of insulin. If you all know the classical textbook knowledge of insulin and then the pro-insulin and the C-peptide, well, perhaps conovenom and conopeptide are doing something similar. And indeed, very recently, there was a Nature Structure Molecular Biology paper where a minimized human insulin receptor binding motif revealed in conus was described. So, this is my summary. I hope I have given you an example of 13 families of so far neglected peptides, disulfide-free or poor, with a lot of pharmacological potential, certainly in neurobiology, and we only can hope that people will use these interesting structures for further elucidation of mechanism. With this, I thank again Eugène Grischin. It was really a privilege to have been able to work with him together and also with his collaborators nowadays. So it will be really, really an eternal legacy. And I thank you for your attention.
Really impressive biodiversity of this modest group of animals. Any questions, Sintlin, and then you?
Very impressively and very generously, you presented a combination of disulfide poor conotoxins. And could you find at least one of them which would act on nicotinic receptors?
We are in the process of having one together with Chris Ullens, that you know, who is more the crystallographer.
Exactly.
But it's still very, very premature to... we have indications that there are some of them indeed working on nicotinic, also on potassium channels.
Yeah, it would be such a nice point on the way to drug. Yeah.
But the question is always, what about potency? You can find examples, but then the potency is a bit disappointing, and then it's a question, is this really the target to spend work on it further on? So
yeah, I wish you success.
Okay. You had a question.
Yeah.
This is, I'm sorry, the final question.
Hi, thank you very much for this excellent presentation. I understand that the modification of the peptides occurs in the producing organism. Is there any indication that modifications also occur after injection in the target organism and that this might modify the toxicity?
That's a good question. No, the answer is no, because the action is really incredibly fast. There is no time lapse needed. So if the host is, let's say, resistant to glycosylation or whatever, okay, their genes have, let's say, adopted modified sodium channels for, like, also examples like tetrodotoxin, for instance. But the modification, once the toxin is really being delivered, to the best of my knowledge, at least, there is no evidence that then still modifications may occur.
Thank you very much.